The first thing was to try to form an advisory board. I realized that we needed some people who were doctors and lawyers and who had credibility that those of us who had founded it, we were unknowns. Nobody knew us. We didn't have any particular credibility. So I began to contact people like Lester Grinspoon at Harvard and Norman Zinberg at Harvard, and Ann Kaplan was a professor of law at Stanford. There were a number of early people who had written books or otherwise indicated their interest in legalizing marijuana. So I began to contact each of them and asking them if they would be comfortable serving on our advisory board. And of course, then we made up our letterhead and prominently listed our advisory board on the side. But the real thing that gave Normal an agenda, we didn't have to look for, it was in front of us. The National Commission on Marijuana and Drug Abuse had been created in the Controlled Substances Act of 1970. And the only thing about it that was decent was a provision that former Congressman Ed Koch from New York managed to get included. He put in a provision in the Controlled Substances Act that established this National Commission on Marijuana and Drug Abuse. And it was a commission of which four members were appointed from Congress, and nine members were appointed by former President Richard Nixon. And Nixon had been out front about his hostility towards marijuana. He thought it was a killer drug and led to heroin, and he indicated to the commission, he didn't want the commission created, but he just didn't have a choice. And when it was, once it was established and the members were appointed, former Governor Raymond Schaefer from Pennsylvania was made the chairman, and Richard Nixon told him publicly, don't even think about coming back with a marijuana legalization recommendation. So we did not expect a lot from the commission. Their first hearings were being held in real early in the first few months of Normal's existence. I think in March of 71, I believe, may have been the first commission hearings. They were here in Washington, D.C. And they had mostly anti-marijuana zealots testifying, and I was there physically, and I listened to the testimony. It was just hideous. It was frightful to think that that was still being said. It was all of the old marijuana leads to heroin sort of stuff, reefer madness stuff. So what I would do is the commission would hold hearings for two or three days, and when they broke for lunch at those hearings, I managed, with Ed Koch's support, to get a room in the same building on on Capitol Hill where we would hold a Normal press conference, and I would have people like Norman Zinberg and Andy Weil and Lester Grinspoon and other qualified PhDs and researchers who would immediately stand up in front of the same cameras that had been covering the Marijuana Commission hearing and say that simply is not accurate. That person is using misinformation that was put out by Harry Anslinger in the 1930s, and we should be moving beyond that. So that evening on the national news, it's true, they always covered the Marijuana Commission hearings, but once they covered their hearing, they would then switch over and they would cover the Normal press conference. What I underestimated, and later turned out to be a major positive development, is the marijuana commissioners themselves, most of them were reasonable people who wanted to do an honest job. And they even established nights where they invited adult, mature marijuana smokers to come to private sessions where the marijuana smokers would smoke in front of the commissioners. The commissioners were generally people who had never seen anyone smoke marijuana. They didn't even know what it looked like. But they wanted to find out exactly what does marijuana do to you when you smoke. Well, after they held a few of these private hearings, obviously it turned their minds around. So at the end of that two-year period, when they came back to make the recommendation to the President and to Congress, it's true, they did not recommend legalizing marijuana in the sense that there would be a legally regulated market. Nixon had indicated they shouldn't even consider that, and I think, frankly, they just thought politically it was too far to go. But what they did do was come back and suggest that we should stop arresting responsible marijuana smokers. And that's a concept that subsequently became known as decriminalization. It would still be a crime to sell marijuana. It would still be a crime, unfortunately, to grow marijuana, but at least the 90% of the arrests that were focused on simple marijuana smokers would no longer be a crime if these recommendations were enacted. Now, real quickly, let me just add that why that also became important was the Marijuana Commission went out of business at the end of those 2 years. They had no mechanism built into the law for them to try to implement their recommendations. So Normal became the vehicle to do that. We then would take the experts, some of their own commissioners and some of the commission staff, but also Grinspoon and Zinberg and other people like that. We would use our funding from Playboy to fly them to any state legislature where we had a young member of the legislature willing to introduce a marijuana decriminalization bill. And we had lots of states, probably 30 different states, where bills were introduced during the 70s. We would fly out a supporting group of 3 or 4 or 5 people to testify so that if the local police testified against it, at least we had an impressive array of witnesses testifying why it made sense. And so Normal's, most of our work during the 1970s was actually trying to implement the recommendations of the Marijuana Commission. So obviously the commission had an enormous impact on our work.